In almost every game they've been a part of, Unknown have had something unique to offer in regards to shiny hunting. In Generation 2, only Unknown I and Unknown V could be shiny. In Sinnoh, the multitude of Unknown are spread out across multiple rooms. In Oras, they were exclusive to Mirage Islands. In Legends, you can't even shiny hunt them until you found each Unknown hidden across Hisui, and in Pokemon Go, Unknown are so uncommon in the wild that they are pretty well event exclusive. But today, we're going to dive into the mechanics of one of my favorite Pokemon games of all time, Pokemon FireRed and Pokemon Leafgreen. If you had never fully explored the FireRed and Leafgreen postgame, it could have been unknown to you that these Pokemon even spawned in them. Heck, even if you had spent hundreds of hours in these games, you might have forgotten about the ancient ruins that are hidden away off the coast of Seven Island. Upon visiting these ruins, the Tanoby Chambers, Unknown won't even spawn unless the player has completed the Tanoby Key puzzle, meaning that many trainers likely came and went through the ruins without learning of the rare Pokemon that lived upon their walls. Once the puzzle has been completed, the 26 letters of the Unknown alphabet will begin to spawn, spread out amongst the seven chambers found in the Tanoby ruins. Additionally, the Minean chamber and the Via Poes chamber are the first locations in the Pokemon series that Unknown question mark and exclamation mark can be found in the wild. Though many familiar with the Pokemon franchise would probably have thought that the punctuation Unknown made their debuts in Pokemon Diamond and Pearl, because both the question mark and exclamation mark Unknown have a measly 1% encounter rate in rooms otherwise completely filled with the letters A or Z. Unknown spawning across multiple rooms isn't anything unique to Generation 3 though. So what is? Avid shiny hunters have probably heard through the grapevine that FireRed and Leafgreen Unknown have some sort of broken shiny rates. Today, I want to break down exactly what it is that makes these rates unique and discuss exactly how rare these bluish symbols actually are. To fully understand the secrets of the Tanoby Chambers, we're going to need to break down a few concepts first. How FireRed and Leafgreen determine what letter an Unknown will be, how Generation 3 games determine the shininess of a Pokemon, and a little bit of
math.
The rest of this video serves as a translation of research done by friend shiny hunter Angaflow. The original research is in the description below. To start, let's discuss how these games decide what letter an unknown will be. When a player triggers an encounter, a random number is generated on the game's encounter table. The FireRed and Leafgreen encounter tables consist of 12 encounter slots. Each slot has a different weight, and the Pokemon that is generated correlates to where the random roll lands on the table. Once an unknown form has been selected, the game begins rolling random PIDs until it finds one that matches the form that needs to be generated. Okay, now I know many of you might not know what a PID is, so let me give you a quick rundown. A Pokemon's PID, or Pokemon ID, is a 32-bit number that is supposed to act kind of like its signature. Under normal circumstances, each Pokemon you encounter will have a randomly generated PID. Depending on which game you're playing, this number can be used to determine nature, gender, ability, form, evolution path, spot pattern, and of course, shininess. For now, let's break down how the PID is used in Generation 3 to determine which form an unknown will take. Looking at a 32-bit number can be quite dizzying when it's all laid out in binary. To digest such numbers more easily, we can group these bits, which are represented by ones or zeros, into bytes, which are aggregations of 8 bits. For most people, 8 bits is still a lot to digest all at once, and they can be cut down further into nibbles, which are groups of 4 bits. In Generation 3, when the game is determining the form of an unknown, it will take the last 2 bits from each byte of the PID to create something I will, from this point on, call the UID, short for Unknown ID. This UID is then modded by 28 to determine the form of an unknown. If you don't know what a modulo operation is, let me briefly explain. Before learning long division, you might have learned division with something called remainders. Most people forget about remainders, but they have a lot of versatility in computer science and everyday life. Say we have $10 to split between 4 people. Obviously, giving them each $2.50 would give each person equal amount of money. But what about when we have indivisible items to distribute evenly. If we had 10 marbles to evenly distribute between 4 people, would it make any sense to give someone half of a marble? A better solution would be to give each person 2 marbles with 2 leftover or 2 remaining marbles. A modulo operation is used to get this remainder. If we take a look at our UID, which is an 8-bit number, we can calculate that there are 256 possible UIDs. 256 is a whole lot more than 28, so the game performs a mod 28 operation to the UID, which will result in a number ranging between 0 to 27 inclusive. This number is then used to determine which form of unknown the UID would correlate to. Taking a look at the previously calculated 256 possible UIDs raises an interesting question though. With 256 UIDs, is there an even distribution of unknown across all possible UIDs? This is a great opportunity to utilize those remainders yet again. 256 divided by 28 results in 9, remainder 4. This means that 4 unknown forms will occur 10 times across all of the possible UIDs, compared to just 9 for the others. Taking a look at the final 4 UIDs reveals that A, B, C, and D unknown will have about 11% more possible PIDs than other individual letters. Okay, with a better understanding of PIDs and UIDs, let's jump back to how the games generate unknown encounters. Once the game has decided which unknown form it needs, it will roll PIDs over and over until it finds one that correlates to the form that is needed. Once it finds one, boom, we have an unknown with a random PID and the game has stayed true to the encounter table. Though, in reality, none of that really matters until we start looking into what makes a Pokemon shiny. In generations 3 through to generation 6, the shininess of a Pokemon is tied directly to both the PID of a Pokemon and the IDs of a player. A player has 2 IDs, the trainer ID, which is visible on the trainer card and on a Pokemon summary page, and a secret ID, which is hidden during regular gameplay. These 2 IDs are each 16-bit numbers, meaning that they can range from 0 to 65,535. To determine if a Pokemon is shiny, the games take the 2 IDs of the trainer and compares them against the PID of the Pokemon using multiple bitwise XOR operations. If you aren't familiar with exclusive OR operations, don't worry, here's a basic rundown. An XOR operator is used to compare 2 bits. If exactly 1 bit is equal to 1, then the result will be 1. Otherwise, the result will be 0. A bitwise operation is one that is done on each pair of bits between 2 operands, so it kind of go 1 by 1 by 1 by 1 until it's run through the entire set of required operations. If we take a look at the truth table for XOR operations, we can see that any 2 randomly generated bits have a 50% chance to result in 0 and a 50% chance to result in 1 when XOR'd together. If we take the TID and the SID of a trainer, we could apply a bitwise XOR operator to get something I, from now on, will be calling the shiny TID. Additionally, XOR operators are commutable, which means we can apply them in any order we want without affecting the result. With this knowledge in hand, let's take a look at the formula used to determine shininess. From generations 3 to generation 5, a Pokemon is shiny if this formula results in a number less than 8. In generation 6, this number was changed to 16. PID 1 is the first 2 bytes of a Pokemon's PID, and PID 2 is the final 2 bytes. Personally, I like to reduce this down to what I call a shiny PID, and reduce the trainer's IDs down to a shiny TID, which ends up looking like this. The ever-famous 1 in 8192 odds stems from the fact that there are 65,536 possible results, where 8 of them are less than 8.
Unknown gets funky when we consider the fact that both the shininess and the form of the Pokemon is tied directly to the PID of Unown. This means each shiny TID will only have some Unown IDs that can be shiny. So let's investigate how this affects the odds.
Since Pokemon are only shiny when the result of this formula is less than 8, we can deduce that in order for an Unown to be shiny, the XOR operation between these bits has to be 0. The reason the other parts of the UID aren't important here is because they're part of the final 3 bits of the shiny PID, which can actually be anything, since the numbers ranging from 0 to 7 span all possible 3-bit numbers. This means that in the full shiny comparison, these 2 bits in the shiny TID are the only ones that have any relation to an Unown's letter. We will call these bits the Unown Trainer ID. For each of the possible Unown Trainer IDs, we'll need to figure out how many of the possible shiny PIDs are allocated to each letter of Unown. To do this, I threw together a function that runs through each UID, determines which letter it's for, and then checks which Unown Trainer ID would be shiny eligible. With this, we can discern the ratios of how many of a trainer's total shiny PIDs are allocated to each letter. Looking at this spreadsheet, we can see that if a trainer's Unown TID was 0, 1 in 16 of their shiny PIDs would be allocated to Unown A, whereas just 1 in 64 of them would be for Unown K. A link to this spreadsheet is available in the description. With these ratios in hand, we're on the cusp of discovering the true shiny rates of Firered and Leafgreen. Since we know a PID is a 32-bit number, we can calculate that there are roughly 4.3 billion possible PIDs. With 4.3 billion possible PIDs, how many exist for each form? If we divide the number of total PIDs by 256, we can calculate how many times the entire set of UIDs exist in all PIDs. If we take this number and multiply it by 10, we can calculate how many Unown exist for each of the letters A, B, C, and D, while multiplying by 9 gives us how many Unown exist for all of the other letters. So we can see that of the roughly 4.3 billion PIDs that exist, the letter A would have about 168 million possibilities, and the question mark Unown would have approximately 151 million possible PIDs. So how can we calculate the shiny odds for a specific trainer? First, we need to discern the trainer's Unown ID. In this case, the UID is 2. To calculate the shiny odds for the exclamation Unown, we take a look at the shiny ratio for that letter for UID 2. In this case, 3 in 64 shiny PIDs will correlate to Unown exclamation mark. All trainers have a total of 524,288 possible shiny PIDs in Generation 3. We know this to be true because there are only 8 shiny PIDs per shiny TID that can be shiny, and each shiny PID will have 65,536 corresponding PIDs. With a ratio of 3 in 64, we now know that 24,567 of those PIDs will be shiny Unown exclamation mark. Finally, we take the number of total exclamation mark Unown that exist and get shiny odds of 1 in 6,144.
We can then repeat this calculation for all Unown TIDs and discern the shiny odds for all situations. What is truly wild is how much these rates can vary. Some rates are as low as 1 in 5,120, while others can be as high as 1 in 18,432. Of course, all of this is meaningless without knowing your trainer's secret ID, which is unfortunate because your SID isn't something the game ever intended players to be able to see. However, if you already happen to have a non-bred shiny Pokemon that you caught on your copy of FireRed or Leafgreen, it is totally doable thanks to Smarty Pants RNG researchers. First, we need to figure out the IVs of our shiny Pokemon, which can be done using Metal Kid's IV calculator. Once you have your Pokemon's IVs, you can plug them into the IV to PID applet, and it should offer you at least one possible secret ID. We can then take this and put it into Rex's unknown TID calculator to find our unknown TID. If you happen to get more than one possible secret ID, put each of them in and see if you get the same unknown TID for all possibilities. If you do, you can still confirm your SID. If not, you'll most likely need to find the IVs of another shiny Pokemon. And there it is, a full explanation of exactly what it is that makes shiny unknown so gosh darn crazy in Generation 3. If you like this video, please hit subscribe and smack that bell icon so you can get notified when part 2 of this video goes live, where we're going to be diving into what the shiny rates end up being per chamber and how many encounters you could expect to do to get a full shiny alphabet in Generation 3. If you like Pokemon math and you want to dive into some more math behind the mons, check out the other videos we have on the channel. If you have any questions about anything that was discussed today, please drop a comment down in the comments section, reach out to me on our Discord, or catch one of our live streams at twitch.tv/professorslab. Thank you so much for watching. If you have any topics that you think we should discuss in the future, drop a comment below. I'm always looking for new, fun Pokemon facts to dive into. Anyways, that's the end of the video. I gotta get back to looking for new blue letters on my portable DVD player. We'll catch you in the next one.